right? So this is the image of kidney having a adrenal gland on the upper pole, and that is why it is called suprarenal gland. Supra means superior part of the kidney, renal, that is the kidney. So it is situated on the upper pole of the kidney on both the sides. Now if we see the cross section of the adrenal gland, this is the cross section of adrenal gland that is been divided into two parts. The outer part is the adrenal cortex, inner part is the adrenal medulla. So today's our topic is hormones which are secreted from the adrenal medulla. Now catecholamines that we are going to learn today, which are secreted from the adrenal medulla, are mainly secreted from two things, that is the post ganglionic sympathetic fibers and adrenal medulla. So they are secreted from these two things, that one which is secreted from the nerve fibers, that is the sympathetic nerve fibers, they are called neurotransmitters, right? And then they enter into the circulation because they are secreted from the nerves. Whereas the catecholamines, which are secreted from the adrenal medulla, they are called hormone. They directly enters into the circulation. So this is the only one difference between, main difference between that they, the structure wise they are same. Both are catecholamines, but the location of secretion is different. Otherwise, all the things are same. Now what is adrenal medulla? This is the adrenal medulla. This is the structure. It represents specialized sympathetic ganglion. Now medulla, you can take it as a ganglion. Now you all know what is ganglion. Ganglion is a simple relay station for the preganglionic fibers, that is the sympathetic fibers. You can see this is a central nervous system. You can take it as a spinal cord, right? And from here, this is the neuron. It extends the axon in the form of nerve fiber. And okay, so this is the preganglionic fibers, and they innervate the adrenal medulla. Now these act as a ganglion because now normally what happens from here, the these nerve endings of the preganglionic fibers synapses with the postganglionic fibers, right? That is the fibers which comes out from the ganglion, they are called postganglionic fibers. Now here you can see that preganglionic fibers just end over here. These are the endings, and these are the cells of the adrenal medulla. Now these cells are, they act as a postganglionic cell because without axons, they do not have fibers, postganglionic fibers. They are only cell. You can say cell body, right? So this is this structure acts as a ganglion, right? But without axons. So it represents specialized sympathetic ganglion because it doesn't have a postganglionic fibers as other sympathetic ganglion has, right? And it is innervated by preganglionic sympathetic nerve fibers, neurons. Okay, so from spinal cord, it gets the nerve fibers that innervates the adrenal medulla cell, and then it ends. There are no postganglionic fibers. So it is a specialized sympathetic ganglion. Now what is structure of a medulla? It is made up of multiple chromaffin cells. So the cells of the adrenal medulla are called chromaffin because it consists of yellow granules into the cytoplasm. So these are the chromaffin cells and has a granules. Now we'll see the significance of granules afterwards. Now these chromaffin cells are of two types. Now, one type of the cell that are, that constitute 80%, and they synthesize epinephrine, okay? And remaining 20% of the chromaffin cells synthesize norepinephrine. So most of the cells synthesize epinephrine and little norepinephrine, right? Now, whatever the epinephrine and norepinephrine which are synthesized into the cells of adrenal medulla, they are stored in a chromaffin granules because they are present in a chromaffin cells. So this is the significance of granules into the cells of adrenal medulla. Okay, so 80% of the cells synthesize epinephrine and 20% of the cells synthesize norepinephrine. So you can see the structure. This is preganglionic cell. It makes the synapse with the cell as a postganglionic neuron. But these neuron does not have a fiber. That is a postganglion. It just ends. And secondly, you can see the capillary. It has a rich blood supply because whatever the hormones which are synthesized and secreted, they immediately can enter into the blood and can circulate into the whole body. So the nerve supply is from T5 and T9 in the form of, they are called splanchnic nerve, and they consist of sympathetic preganglia directly innervate the cells, and these cells act as a modified postganglionic neurons without axons. So normally whatever the postganglionic fibers are there in all the ganglios, here they are absent, but it has a very rich blood supply because hormones directly enters into the blood after secretion. Now you see the hormones of adrenal medulla, as I said, they are the catecholamines, that is epinephrine, norepinephrine and dopamine. Now epinephrine and norepinephrine are also secreted from the nerve endings of the sympathetic nervous system. Now what is the difference between the secretion of epinephrine and norepinephrine is that mainly epinephrine is secreted from the medulla, whereas norepinephrine is secreted in very small amount from medulla. The major source, that is the norepine, is mainly secreted as a neurotransmitter because it is secreted from the nerve terminals of the sympathetic fibers, right? Postganglionic fibers. So medulla, the epinephrine is a major secretion, whereas sympathetic postganglionic fibers, the major secretion occurs of norepinephrine. This is the main difference between the epinephrine and norepinephrine. Now how the synthesis of catecholamines occurs? Now they are amines, right? Now catecholamines are synthesized from the amino acid, that is the tyrosine. This tyrosine is converted into DOPA, that is 3,4-dihydroxyphenylalanine, with the help of tyrosine hydroxylase. So hydroxylation of tyrosine converts it into DOPA. This DOPA is converted into dopamine by decarboxylation. The enzyme is DOPA decarboxylase. Dopamine is converted into norepinephrine by dopamine beta hydroxylase enzyme. Now norepinephrine is converted into epinephrine by phenylethanolamine and methyl transferase. This is the most important enzyme which is required for conversion of norepinephrine to the epinephrine. So in each granules, this hormone is present, right? In short, it is called PNMT, that is phenylethanolamine and methyl transferase. So this is how the synthesis of catecholamines occurs. Now we'll see certain factors which regulate catecholamine synthesis. The first and the most common is acute or a chronic sympathetic stimulation. So any acute or chronic sympathetic stimulation, as for example like stress, right, that stimulate the presympathetic fibers, and that will stimulate the chromaffin cells directly of the chromaffin cells of the adrenal medulla directly, and they increases the synthesis and release of catecholamines by activating all the enzymes which are required for the synthesis of the catecholamines, right? So they just stimulate the activity of enzymes. So that will increase the synthesis and synthesis of the enzyme. The second is ACTH and cortisol, adrenocorticotropic hormone and cortisol. Now this is also very important hormone for the synthesis, to increase the synthesis of the catecholamines. Now they increase synthesis and release by activating enzymes in a stressful conditions. Because whenever we are facing any stressful condition, along with the catecholamines, corticosteroids are also released, and they also stimulate the enzymes that causes synthesis of the catecholamines. So during stressful condition, immediate release of the catecholamines occurs, as well as prolonged release of catecholamine also occurs by the associated increase in release of corticosteroid. These corticosteroids stimulate the synthesis. Third, epinephrine itself stimulates its own synthesis by diffusing from medulla to the cortex. That will stimulate cortical synthesis, and ultimately this corticosteroid will stimulate the synthesis of epinephrine. So it is like a cycle. Now, how the secretion of catecholamines occurs? Now, mainly the secretion of the catecholamines from the adrenal medulla occurs as an integral part of flight or a fight reaction. Now, this reaction occurs whenever we suddenly face a very harmful or dangerous condition, like seeing a lion in front of us, seeing a bomb blast just nearby, right? And this is called a flight or fight reaction. Either if it is a lion or whatever the circumstances has been there, you will decide to fight with that circumstances, or you will leave that place. You will fly away from that place. You will run away from that place. So in both the case, the secretion of catecholamines occurs. Right, and this is evoked by sympathetic stimulation in response to the stress. So whenever there is a stressful condition, the adrenal medulla is stimulated to release catecholamines, that is by sympathetic stimulation. And then you will decide whether you want to fight, or you are going to fight, or you are going to fly, right? And at that time, the secretion of catecholamines occurs in ratio of 4:1. 4 part of the epinephrine and 1 part of norepinephrine are secreted. Okay, so this is an MCQ question. Now, synthesis of catecholamines, we have seen that it occurs from tyrosine to epinephrine with the help of different enzymes. Now, whatever the catecholamines are formed, they are stored into the chromaffin granules. How they are secreted from the chromaffin cells, or we can say from adrenal medulla, and it enters into the blood. Then it will reach to the all the cells of the body. Now, they are secreted in response to the sympathetic nerve endings, because we have seen that sympathetic nerve endings directly innervate the cell of the adrenal medulla. So whenever there is a sympathetic nerve stimulation, that releases acetylcholine. So this is like neuromuscular junction. Not it is a neuromuscular junction, but just remember how the nerve stimulation causes release of acetylcholine at a neuromuscular junction, right? So from the nerve, presympathetic nerve endings, these release acetylcholine, binds with the nicotinic receptors which are present on the chromaffin cells. So neuromuscular junction, also that muscle contains nicotinic receptors. So in our body, nicotinic receptors are present at two sites. First at the neuromuscular junction, second in the adrenal medulla. Other organs consist of muscarinic, acetylcholine, cholinergic receptors, right? So this acetylcholine, once released at chromaffin cells, It binds with the nicotinic receptors which are present on the cells. So this will lead to stimulation of the receptors and causes sodium influx. Now, whenever there is a positive ions are going inside, that positivity inside the cell membrane increases, and that is called depolarization. So depolarization of the cell membrane will lead to calcium influx. Now, calcium is very much important as it will lead to exocytosis of the secretory granules. So whatever the granules which are were present into the cytoplasm will be transported to the cell membrane. They bind with the cell membrane and releases granules by the exocytosis. And the catecholamines which are present in granules, once they are out of the cell, they are released into the, and they enter into the circulation. Once they are in the circulation, they will reach to each and every cell of our body. Now, once the action is over, what will happen to the catecholamines? They must be removed. They cannot remain into the body because that will lead to prolonged action. Now, depending on the site of the release, they are metabolized by two ways. First, the catecholamines which are released by sympathetic nerve endings at the synaptic cleft, they are removed or metabolized either by active neuronal reuptake. So these catecholamines, once the action is over from the cleft, they are taken back from that particular nerve endings, or they diffuses out of the junctional cleft. So that leads to dilution of that part. So ultimately, they are removed from the acting site. Now, the catecholamines which are released from adrenal medulla into the circulation, they are metabolized into the liver and kidney. So these are the two mechanism how they the way they are metabolized and removed from the action. Now, once in the circulation, how they act on the cell? Now, for that, they have two types of the receptors which are present on the cell membrane. They are called adrenergic receptors. They are of two types, alpha and beta. Alpha, again, they are of two types, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Now, these alpha receptors are sensitive to both epinephrine and norepinephrine. They equally sensitive to both types of catecholamines, that is epinephrine and norepinephrine. And when the alpha receptors are stimulated, it has an excitatory effect for all the cells on which they are present, on all the tissues on which they are present, except intestinal motility. Means intestinal smooth vessels having alpha receptors, when they are stimulated, it is inhibited. Means there is a relaxation of the intestinal smooth muscles. Otherwise, once these receptors are stimulated, it causes excitation of that particular tissues. Now, other type is a beta receptors. They are again of three types, beta 1, 2 and 3. They are more sensitive to the epinephrine and insensitive or very less sensitive to the norepinephrine. So if epinephrine binds with the beta receptor, it leads to inhibition of that particular cell action of any particular tissues, except myocardium. So beta cells on myocardium, when they are stimulated, it causes excitation of the myocardium. So these are the MCQ questions you should remember. The action of alpha receptors and action of beta receptors. On which cell they are excitatory, on which cell they are inhibitory. We will not go in details each and every tissues on which type of the receptors they have. That you will learn in an autonomic nervous system. Now coming to the actions of catecholamines, if we see the general consideration, it exert effect by binding with adrenergic receptors. So catecholamines are specific to bind with the adrenergic receptors, or we can say adrenergic receptors are specific for the catecholamines. As we have seen, they are of two types, alpha and beta. Alpha again, alpha 1, alpha 2, beta, that is the beta 1, 2 and 3. Now actions are same as stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system. As for example, if we say the myocardium having a sympathetic nerve supply, if that nerve is stimulated, it increases force of contraction, right? Or if the catecholamines, which are secreted from the adrenal medulla in response to the flight or fight reaction, will reach to the myocardium through blood circulation, it will also lead to increase in force of contraction. Understood? So on either way, either they are secreted from the nerve supplying to that particular tissue, or they are coming through the blood circulation and acting on that particular tissue, the action is same. There is a no difference. Either they are secreted from nerve supply, or either they have secreted from the adrenal medulla, right? Now, but the difference is the due time. The effect of this action remains 10 times longer than produced by the sympathetic stimulation. That means catecholamines release from the adrenal medulla, and now they are acting has a 10 times longer duration of effect compared to the when they are released from the sympathetic nerve supply. Adrenal medulla releases predominantly epinephrine, whereas sympathetic stimulation or sympathetic nerve supply, nerve fibers releases norepinephrine predominantly. This is a MCQ question. Now we'll see the metabolic actions of catecholamines. First, that is the general metabolic effects that occurs via alpha and beta receptors. As I said, I am not going to go in detail which type of the tissues or which type of the receptors, because that you are going to learn it in autonomic nervous system, or you might have learned, right? So stimulation of alpha and beta receptors, catecholamine increases O2 consumption, right? It increases O2 consumption. Now oxygen is utilized for the different metabolic reactions. So increase in O2 consumption causes rise in basal metabolic rate. Now when basal metabolic rate is increased, it also increases heat, right? So it increases O2 consumption, it increases BMR, and it also increases heat production. Now effect on particular carbohydrate metabolism, it produces hyperglycemia. That is anti-insulin action, because insulin causes hypoglycemia. So it produces hyperglycemia, means rise in a glucose. How this is helpful? It makes glucose available for brain and other tissues to meet emergency. So catecholamines are mainly released in a emergencies that we have seen fight or flight reaction occurs, that occurs in any stressful condition. Now in stressful conditions, our body requires high level of glucose, and this is fulfilled, this requirement is fulfilled by release of catecholamines, right? It makes glucose, high level of glucose available into the blood to utilize it for many actions, to either you want to fly, that you want to run away, or you want to fight. In both the cases, you require much more energy, and this energy is provided by high level of glucose into blood circulation, which is made available by epinephrine, catecholamines, right? Now, how this glucose increases in a blood, that by first action of catecholamine, it causes glycogenolysis in muscle and liver. So it breaks down stored glycogen, and you all know glycogen is a simple chain of glucose. So it is broken down. One by one, glucose is made free in the muscle and liver, and it is released into the circulation. So glucose in circulation, that leads to hyperglycemia. Secondly, it causes gluconeogenesis in liver. Now, gluconeogenesis is production or synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate substrate, that is like lactate, pyruvate, amino acids and glycerol. So all these are utilized to synthesize more and more glucose, because the enzymes for gluconeogenesis is present into the liver. So gluconeogenesis produces more and more glucose, and that is again released into the circulation. Another thing, it causes inhibition of the glycogenesis in liver. It also stops formation of glycogen, right? So if glycogen is not formed, so more and more free glucose will be available into the cell for utilization. It also causes inhibition of the insulin secretion. So if insulin is secreted, it will lead to hypoglycemia. And we need hyperglycemia for a fight and flight reaction. So it will inhibit the insulin secretion. So there will not be hypoglycemia, and the blood glucose, high blood glucose level will be maintained into the circulation. Another effect on fat metabolism, it increases free fatty acids in circulation. How? First and last, it causes stimulation of lipase enzyme in the adipose tissue and muscle. So what will happen? Lipase will break down stored triglycerides. Stored triglycerides are the triglycerides are the fat which is not utilized, which are already stored in adipose tissue, which are in the muscle. So this stored fat in the form of triglyceride is broken down by the lipase enzyme. So it stimulates the lipase enzyme. So triglyceride is broken down into free fatty acid and glycerol. And these free fatty acids release from the adipose tissue and muscles, enters into the circulation, and it is utilized by the heart and muscles as a fuel source. So along with glucose, another fuel source which is made available by the catecholamines to fight or fly reaction is free fatty acids, right? And that is mainly utilized by heart as well as muscles. Now there are also different effects and actions of catecholamines on different system of our body. The first effect on cardiovascular system, that is on heart, epinephrine and norepinephrine act via beta 1 receptors, and stimulation of this beta 1 receptors. So we have seen beta receptors are inhibitory for all the tissues except heart, myocardium, right? Here it is excitatory. So stimulation of beta receptors on heart increases heart rate by action on SA node, that is called chronotropic effect. It also increases conduction velocity. So the impulse will travel fast. That is called dromotropic. It also increases the force of contracts, that is called inotropic action, right? So stimulatory effect on heart. On blood vessels, there are two types of the receptors, adrenergic receptors. If it act on alpha receptors, it will lead to vasoconstriction of all the vessels, peripheral vessels into the body. So whenever there is a vasoconstriction of the peripheral blood vessels, it increases the peripheral resistance. So this is how it increases the blood pressure. If it act and stimulate beta receptors as it is inhibitory, it leads to dilatation of skeletal muscle and liver blood vessels. So there is a dilatation of blood vessels into the skeletal muscle and liver. So we can say it is inhibitory for these vessels, otherwise it is excitatory for the peripheral blood vessels. Now, effects on central nervous system having a beta receptors, it activates reticular activating system. That is the important system for arousal, right? So it stimulating the reticular activating system, we can say RAS, R-A-S. It produces arousal, it leads to anxiety, it leads to apprehension, and also cold tremors in the extremities. Now just correlate these signs and symptoms when you are frightened up, right? Seeing lion or having a bomb blast, or if you are caught in the fire, right? All this will happen in you because of stimulation of central nervous system, because of release catecholamines from the adrenal medulla. So this will be very easy if you try to remember what will happen if you will see a stressful condition. And is for example, just make it that you have seen a lion in front of you. What will happen to you, right? It will be very easy to remember all these signs and symptoms and effects on all the system. So the first, heart, your heart rate will be increased and you will have a increased blood pressure on seeing lion. Secondly, you will be aroused, will lead to anxious, it will lead to apprehension, you will start tremoring in your hands and legs. On GIT, beta receptors are inhibitory, so that will lead to relaxation of the smooth muscles of the intestine that decreases the motility. With that, it also stimulates the alpha receptors that causes contraction of the sphincters of the gut. So net result will be constipation. You will not remember to go to washroom when you see a lion in front of you. That is the funny part. And also it will help to remember the effect on GIT. On urinary bladder, you will not remember to go washroom again. That will lead to retention of urine because stimulation of beta receptors will lead to relaxation of the detrusor muscles of the bladder, as well as it will tighten up the sphincters, that by contraction of the sphincter by stimulating the alpha receptors, right? On the skin, you will have a goosebump, right? Alpha receptors that will be stimulated, that the pilomotor muscles are stimulated, that causes piloerection of the hair, as well as you will get a sweat in your palm. That is because sweat glands of the palm and sole are stimulated, that will lead to localized sweating, and that is called adrenergic sweating. Pasina chut jata hai, theek hai? So that is called adrenergic sweating. Now, if generalized sweating is called cholinergic sweating. So this is the difference. The localized sweating is called adrenergic sweating. On skeletal muscles, the beta cells are stimulated by catecholamines. So blood vessels, that will lead to dilatation. So that will increase blood supply to the muscles for your running away or from that side or to even fight. You are going to use your muscles either to run away or to fight. So for that, you will require much more blood supply. So that is done by stimulation of beta receptors, which are present on blood vessels, and that gets dilatation, vasodilatation. So that will increase the blood supply to the muscles as well as during exercise. On eyes, alpha receptor stimulation leads to dilatation of the pupil. That is by contraction of the dilator pupil. So what will happen? The vision will become wide, right? And beta receptor stimulation leads to relaxation of the ciliary muscles. Now, the lens is attached to the ciliary muscles in such a way that if contraction of the ciliary muscles occurs, that will lead to thinning of the lens, tightening of the lens. If there is a relaxation of the ciliary muscles, it leads to flattening of the lens. So anterior curvature of the lens is increase or decrease, right? Now, as there is a relaxation, flattening of lens will lead to it provides a wide and a far vision for this reaction to act, right? On respiration, stimulation of the beta receptors, as it is inhibitory, it leads to relaxation of the smooth muscles of the bronchioles, right? So lumen will be increased because of bronchodilation. Now lumen is increased, so more air can be entered into the lungs, as well as it also increases rate as well as depth of the respiration. So overall, the net result will be it provides better ventilation, better oxygenation, and that will be useful and most important, the oxygenation of all the tissues of your body to react against the stressful condition. In general, the effect on blood, there is a reduction in a blood clot coagulation time. So clotting becomes fast. That is by increasing activity of the factor 5. It also causes contraction of the spleen that leads to increase in RBC count because more RBCs are pushed into the circulation. As hemoglobin is present in RBC, increase in RBC, it also increases the hemoglobin. And PVC, that is the packed cell, or PCV, sorry, it should be PCV, that is my mistake. Packed cell volume is also increased because it is only, mainly, not only, it is mainly RBC count. There is also increase in neutrophil count because all the neutrophils from the blood vessel walls, which are present on blood vessel wall, they will enter into the, they are pushed into circulation. There is increase in plasma proteins by movement of fluid out of the circulation. So relative increase in plasma protein occurs. There is nothing like there is increase in synthesis of plasma protein, but as fluid is moved out of the circulation, relative increase in plasma proteins will occur. On glandular circulation, it has an effect on alpha and beta receptors. It increases the secretion of salivary as well as lacrimal glands. Coming to the applied part, that is any abnormality of the secretion of catecholamines. Now deficiency does not occur because they are also secreted from the sympathetic nerve fibers. So mainly what happens, excess secretion can occur, and that is called pheochromocytoma. And this happens when there is a benign tumor of adrenal medulla occurs. Benign means it is not cancer. It is a simple tumor, that is a excess secretion of the catecholamines occurs from the chromaffin cells. Now, combining all the effects of catecholamines, you can remember the clinical features when what can happen when there is excess of catecholamines in the circulation. As we have seen, it increases heart rate, it increases force of contraction. So ultimately cardiac output is increased, vasoconstriction, peripheral resistance is increased. So ultimately it leads to hypertension. Whenever there is hypertension, it leads to headache. It also leads to chest discomfort as well as abdominal pain. It also leads to tachycardia because of effect on myocardium that increases the heart rate. But when it increases in excess more than 100, the person can feel his or her own heart rate, can feel the heart rate. Otherwise, normally we don't feel our heart rate, right? And if a person is able to feel her or his heart rate, that is called palpitation. There occurs sweating. As I told you, that is the adrenergic sweating. There occurs pallor. Paleness is because of generalized vasoconstriction, and that is the reason for the pallor. We have seen abdominal pain, constipation because of relaxation of the intestinal muscles and contraction of the or increase in tone of the GIT, as well as there is a weight loss and weakness that is because of all these effect on metabolism. How can you find out that person is suffering from pheochromocytoma or to stem the diagnosis? The first is 24 hours urine collection is done and the total amount of catecholamines is estimated. So 24 hours excretion of catecholamines is increased because excessive secretion of catecholamines is happening. Secondly, there will be elevated plasma level of catecholamines because they are secreted in a excess. So absolutely plasma level will also increase. So you can find it out from the going for a plasma level of catecholamines, as well as you can find it out presence and increase in level of catecholamines in the urine, 24 hours urine. Benign tumor of the adrenal medulla. So you can find it out any presence of tumor in the adrenal medulla by CT scan. Now treatment for the pheochromocytoma is only and only surgical excision. But before excision or after excision, medical treatment is must. So that is necessary, or sometimes it is inoperable cases. The tumor is such that it is not possible to remove it. In that case, medical treatment is done by the alpha and beta blockers to control the hypertension, right? This is the last thing that you, dopamine, that is the dopamine which is secreted from the adrenal medulla. The physiological functions of dopamine which is secreted in circulation from the adrenal medulla is unknown still, right? But if it is injected dopamine produces renal vasodilatation, as well as it also leads to vasodilatation in the mesentery, that is the intestine. And on heart, it has a positive inotropic effect. So that increases the force of contraction. So sometimes some cardiac problems, the dopamine drip is given. That is particularly in cardiogenic shock, in which force of contraction is increased by injecting the dopamine. So this is the end of my today's lecture. If you have any query, you can ask me questions, please. No questions.